What do you think of or feel when you hear the term think like a girl? Does it make you recoil like it makes me recoil? Because for as long as I can remember, that's always been used as kind of an insult. Well, Dr. Tracy Alloway is changing that narrative completely. With her latest book called Think Like a Girl, she uses incredible science to show us that having a girl brain is really cool. You've written a new book. It's called Think Like a Girl. Can you tell me, because there's a lot of connotations to that phrase, think like a girl, right? So can you tell me a little bit about it?
Yeah, so I intentionally chose that title, Think Like a Girl, because, you know, as a girl, a lot of times you hear a lot of negative things like, oh, stop making decisions like a girl, stop, you know, acting like a girl. And it's not always very positive. And I really wanted to just address some of these myths head on, some of these stories that we hear. Sometimes we tell it to ourselves and sometimes we hear it from people around us. And I really wanted to look a little bit under the hood. So what's happening in our brain? So one myth that I look at is it really true that women are more emotional when we make decisions, for example? And this is really stemming right out of my research lab where I brought both, lots of different people in, and I wanted to look to see how we make decisions in a very tough, difficult situation. And I use the trolley dilemma, a very familiar moral dilemma, and I asked people how they would respond. But I added a twist. I asked them to stick their hand in a bucket of ice just for 1 minute. And here's why I saw a switch happen. We have two pathways when we make decisions. We have an emotional pathway that relies on our amygdala, our emotional brain. And we have a second pathway, our cold or rational decision-making center, relying on our front of the brain, the prefrontal cortex. And both, you know, men and women, all of us use these two different pathways. Now, what I found is women are really wanting to protect. We don't want to cause harm. And this can be perceived as acting weakly or emotionally. If you want to flip the switch and make a less emotional decision, sticking your hand in a bucket of ice activates the stress response. It activates your emotional brain. And so your amygdala, your emotional brain, is so busy dealing with this ice that it frees up your rational brain to make a more rational decision.
That's incredible. I think that that's so interesting. I don't think that we think about, when we talk about especially gendered thinking, I don't think we actually think about what's going on in our brains. We just assign these values to different genders and assume that they'll respond this way because of whatever sort of societal reason we've put on them. So I think that that's really incredible and interesting. How did you come to want to do that, I guess, that much research and clinical time put in to write a book? I mean, that seems just incredibly above and beyond to me.
Really motivated by a lot of what you described, Destiny. When I would, you know, as a scientist, as a researcher, when I would begin to read these scientific articles, it seemed like a one size fits all. That whenever we talk about brains or behaviors or you know, cognitive development, it seems just one broad brushstroke across all of us. And when I began to look at the data from my own lab, I began to see that wasn't the case. Sometimes we do respond differently. But there are ways in which we can change the way that acts if we wanted to. And there may be a reason for that. It's not just because we're wired that way. So another thing that I address is empathy and whether or not, you know, being, do we have to be more masculine, more male-like to be a good leader in the workplace? And again, there's lots of research to show that male-like traits like being aggressive, always being right, or being the center of attention. And these, again, are from a lot of what researchers have pulled out, that when women take that on board, they're actually perceived as weaker leaders. And in my own lab, I wanted to look a bit more closely. So I began to survey Fortune 500 women and find out what it is that's driving them. And I found a very interesting pattern. That first of all, our leadership style is exactly that. It's a style. We're not fixed to one way of leading. Sometimes we require to be a more collaborative or connective or empathetic leader. Other times we need to be more goal-directed, more kind of focused on what's ahead. And there's times in which both of those have value. But instead of trying to push us to say, oh, well, you're a woman, you must be more empathetic, or you're not a man, so you have to be one way or another. Where I found that when we feel pushed into being a particular type of leader, that's what leads to stress and burnout in women. And so it's almost like when you're not being an authentic leader, when you're not kind of reading the room and acting in a way that as a leader you feel is true to that situation, that's when we begin to see the toll on our own personal mental health.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I mean, from all the research that you've looked at to distill it down, so I guess not simply, but easy to understand, I think is truly incredible. And so it just makes me all the more excited to read the book. But also, I guess that leads me to my next question is, who do you think, obviously this is a book that women can glean a lot from, but who do you think might be interested in reading a book like this? And on top of that, what do you think is the most interesting thing that you learned while you were working through this process?
Yeah, the result, actually, when I talk to people, I get so excited about it. You know, whenever I read something new, I've written a little something, I love getting feedback. And the response has been so incredibly positive. You know, from guys, I'm hearing, oh, my partner would love to know this, or I want to know this so that I can understand them a bit better. You know, my father saying, I really want to know this so I understand my daughters. I've had mothers say, I want to read this together with my teenager so together we can understand the brain better and how powerful it is that at this young age she can see how she's making decisions and how to kind of maximize the way her brain is naturally working. So that's really exciting for me to hear the kind of feedback that people are excited about it too. For me personally, I try to put in practice a lot of what I've written in the book. So there are 10 chapters and I cover how the brain works in a lot of different areas, in leadership, in decision making, both in stress, in risk taking, in love, when I talk about attraction and bonding, in happiness. And, you know, we know, for example, that women are twice as likely to get diagnosed with depression, other mental illness. Now, there's a lot of reasons for that. But one of the reasons is neurological. Women have 3 times more receptors that attend to stress compared to men. Now, this doesn't mean that we're fixed or that we're forced into this position, but I also wanted to step back and say, well, now that we know this, what can we do about it? And one powerful thing that I suggest, so at the end of every chapter, I have what I call think takeaways. And at the end of this particular chapter, I talk about how just changing one word can be so powerful. So instead of saying yes, but, because we know as part of the female brain, it's set up to ruminate. We kind of fall into the spiral. So again, this is based on a large scale study from my own research lab. I had close to 4,000 participants. And I found that for men, the buffer against mental illness or depression is a sense of agency, a sense of being able to know, hey, I can change this. I'm in control of the situation. For women, it was a different indicator. It was what we call rumination, the cycle. You know, what you hear sometimes people say, why can't I get out of it? I just keep thinking about what I did wrong and what I should have done instead. And so a way to kind of flip the switch again or move away from that is instead of saying, yes, but if I did this, say, yes, and I did this great thing. And yes, and I've learned this lesson. And we also see from other research that it switches this perspective to one of gratitude. What have you done correctly? And it can actually rewire the way in which our brain responds to situation. There's amazing. There's an amazing body of brain imaging studies showing that when you adopt that position of gratitude, different parts of your brain are activated to now attend, to have that kind of spotlight on, hey, what am I grateful for in this situation, instead of the yes, but approach.
I think that's like really incredible. I mean, as somebody who, I don't know, couldn't be farther from studying the brain, probably. I love to hear things like that because I think so many women who will hear about this and that you've told about it can relate to those sorts of things that feel automatic to us. You know, mm-hmm. We feel like we're put into the world. This is our lot. You know, you take your path in life, but there's so much that you can do that you have, like you said, agency to do, to change things that feel really big and unchangeable. And I think that that's so cool. What, besides, I guess, you mentioned, you know, a lot of your own studies sort of inspired this book, but and kept you going. But what made you even want to start to tackle a topic like this? It's so hot right now, these discussions of gender bias and gender equity and equality. I mean, that's a big topic to tackle.
I think exactly like you said, now is the right kind of time. There's a platform for us to be able to understand ourselves even more, but not feel constrained by that, to know that we do have the power to actually use our brain efficiently and also change a little bit of how we do use our brain. So I want us to be able to have that really positive message. I have nieces, you know, I want them to grow up in the world knowing that, first of all, they don't have to believe these myths, these stories that they hear about themselves simply because they're a girl. And it's not a sign of weakness or none of these things that are natural to us, like empathy and so on. They're not necessarily a sign of weakness. So I first of all wanted to create that sense of awareness for how our brain is working. And second of all, I wanted the reader to be able to walk away with a sense of agency, a sense of, I can do this. This is what I can do. If I want to make a different decision, if I want to be a better leader, if I want to, you know, find how to work on my mental health and find that moment for myself. So
I'll admit, this interview was supposed to go out before the book came out, but good news for you, the book is already out, so you can get it wherever books are sold near you, your favorite local bookstore, of course, online. I have ordered mine. I'm excited to receive it. And if you want to read it too with me, we can chat about it. You can find me on social media. I'm on Twitter at @hello_destiny. I'd love to read it with you, but you should follow Dr. Tracy Alloway. She's incredible. She writes everything from like very hardcore scientific papers to like children's books about memory to, of course, stuff like this. And she's just great. And I love whenever she contacts me to interview her about her stuff, because I love talking to incredibly smart women who are using their brain power to help other women. I just think that's so cool. And look, this book isn't just for ladies. This is for everybody. If you're interested in how, like, the female, biological female brain works, check it out. If you want to bust some myths about how your brain works, check it out. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you guys next week, same-ish time, same place. And until then, this has been Nerd News with Destiny.